action, and I'll do it.
There I was on death row, guilty in the first degree. Son of God hanging on the hill, hell was my destiny. The crowd was shouting, crucify, could have come from these lips of mine. Dirty shame was killing me. It would take a miracle to wash me clean. Then I read the red letters and the ground began to shake. All my sins are for by the blood. I'm no stranger to the prison. I've worn shackles and chains, but I've been freed and forgiven. And I'm not going back, I'll never be the same. So I say, oh, my hope is in Jesus. Thank God my yesterday's gone. All my sins are forgiven. I've been washed by the blood. There's a kind of thing that just breaks a man. Break him down to his knees. God, I've been broken more than a time or two. Yes, Lord, then he picked me up and showed me what it means to be a man. Come on and sing.
Good to see everybody. Welcome everybody who's watching Facebook Live tonight on our Sunday night live services, if you will. Live streaming, it won't be long. We'll be able to get back into the house of God and do Sunday night live. But we are heading back into the church next Sunday morning. That'll be May the 10th at 10:30 in the main sanctuary. 8:15, we'll be having their services back in here. We will be doing social distancing in those services, and thank God. And we will continue to do Sunday Night Live via Facebook. Also, we will be going into the sanctuary on Wednesday nights at 7 o'clock. So please come out if you're able and join us if you feel comfortable in doing those things. If not, we are, if you want to come and park in the parking lot, like we have been having drive-in church. We had one more today, and thank God it was a beautiful, sunny, warm morning, and it was real great. And the Lord showed up. We had a guest speaker, Leon Jones, was here this morning, and we had a great move of God. And I was telling him earlier today, I said, God ain't limited by parking lots or buildings or any viruses. He's still God, amen, and he's still on his throne, and he's still moving in the midst of his people. But tonight, just a few little things on that. Don't forget, like I said, we will be going into the main sanctuary at 10:30 next Sunday, which is Mother's Day. So remember those things. If you got any questions, please see our Facebook page. If you got any questions, please hit the connect button. And if you got a comment or prayer request or connections, or if you're just watching and enjoying what we've been doing, please let us know. Also, just a quick thing on giving. If you're able to give and would like to give, please, you can go on our Facebook page. You can go on our website page. You can give in those manners. And if you got any questions, like I said, please hit the connect button, and or somebody that monitors you, that they will get back to you about that. Amen. But all that being said, it is good to have everybody tuning in. I like to say see everybody because we're used to seeing people, but I don't see you. You see me, but I can't see you. But we are glad that you're watching and glad that hopefully that you're being fed through these services and through these times on Facebook and live streaming. Just remember that and just a few things like that. And keep in mind, we are praying for you. We're still praying. We're still believing and knowing that God's beginning to move and that we are beginning to get back to a semi-normal state as of right now, hopefully to a full normal state very soon in this country. Things will begin to be opening up. We're going by the guidelines designated by our governor and also by our city officials. So please come out if you're able or you feel comfortable to and be part of the services. Tonight, I'm going to jump in. I'm still in the little series called The Enemy of Your Destiny or The Enemies of Your Destiny. And we've got a few more to go. And God gave me this series not long before all this started taking place. And I didn't know when or where I was going to preach it, but the Lord has given the opportunities for Sunday night to fulfill that. And hopefully it's been helpful. Hopefully it's encouraged you. Hopefully it's equipped you and empowered you to defeat the enemies of your destiny. And we'll just read the scripture real quick and we'll jump into the message. In Deuteronomy chapter 7, verse 1, we've been reading this same passage because it brings us to the point we need to be. It says, "When the Lord thy God shall bring thee into the land whither thou goest to possess it, and hath cast out many nations before thee, the Hittites, the Girgashites, the Amorites, the Canaanites, and the Perizzites, and the Hivites, and the Jebusites, seven nations greater and mightier than thou." Verse 2 says, "And when the Lord thy God shall deliver them," means he's going to, "before thee, thou shalt smite them and utterly destroy them. Thou shalt make no covenant with them, nor shew mercy unto them. Neither shalt thou make marriages with them. Thy daughters thou shalt not give unto his sons, and nor his daughters shalt thou take unto thy son." Pray with me and pray for me tonight. Father, we come to you today, God, giving you thanksgiving and praise. We thank you for this beautiful sunny weather that we've had today, God. God, we thank you for now that we're beginning to open up things and beginning to get back, and we're able to get back into the house of God, Father, Lord. Lord, we thank you, God, for the men and women who have come out and worked so hard and diligently to make these things happen, that we can still get the word out and we can still preach the gospel and people can be fed spiritually, Father, Lord. And Lord, we come tonight, God, continually asking you one more time to come into this place, God. Anoint me, your son and your servant, God. Anoint these lips of clay, God. Speak to me and through me, not of the wisdom of men, but divine power and revelation of the Holy Ghost, Father, God. For without you, God, we're nothing. Without you, Lord, these words are you have to be in the mix, Father, Lord. And God, we're asking you, God, the healer, the deliverer, the chain breaker, if you will, the Savior and the Redeemer, the anointer, Father God, the sanctifier, the Holy Ghost baptizer, Father God, to come in this place and through the airwaves, if you will, God, settle right down into the people's homes tonight, God. Settle down right now if they're listening by their car, or they're listening where out on the deck or wherever they're at, or by the poolside if they've got one, Father Lord. And God, we ask you to move in a mighty and miraculous and powerful way, God. Anoint your word and let it go forth and do its work tonight, Father God. Save, sanctify, fill with the Holy Ghost, heal, deliver, strengthen, encourage, and set free tonight, Father God. Lord, we ask you, God, comfort and bring peace to people, Father God. Encourage people tonight, Father God. And Lord, we ask you, God, most importantly, let your will and your way be done in this house, Father Lord, and throughout this message tonight, Father God. And we ask it in your name, Jesus, we pray. Amen. Everybody say amen at your house. Amen. Amen. I know it's strange, but you can say amen at your house. You know you can pray at your house. Hopefully you are. But you can worship in your house. We sometimes get moved out of our place. I was telling somebody today, we've went through a rough time and an untime of uncertainty. But really the truth of the matter is we've just really been inconvenienced. And it takes us out of our norm, takes us out of our comfort zone. And I thought about that, and even myself, I'm way out of my comfort zone. I shared it a couple of weeks ago. I ain't even in the same ballpark. Where I thought was comfortable, I'm just way out of here because this is not comfortable in itself, but the fact of the matter is God had a purpose and God's got a plan. And that's what I want to talk to you a little bit about tonight as we continue to build into the foundations of this enemies of your destiny. God's got a purpose. We continue to just lay a little foundation to bring you abreast if you're new to watching this series. But God, at this moment, Joshua's beginning, became a leader of the new generation of Israel and entered into a land of Canaan as the Lord had promised. God gave him an important commandment, and this was the commandment. He says, when thou goest into the land to possess it, there's many enemies in there, and you have to cast out many nations. And they were the Hittites. We talked about them. They were the Girgashites. We've talked about them. The Amorites, and we've talked about them. And the Canaanites, we've talked about them. Tonight, we're going to talk about the Perizzites, I'm hoping how you pronounce it. But we've got to understand that these enemies were possessing the destiny that Israel had. And even in our own spiritual walk, we've been given a destiny. The Bible says that they were given a land that was flowing with milk and honey. It was so big of a blessing that the grapes they saw, it took two men to carry them out. I want you to understand something tonight, and I hope you get it through this series. God has given you a destiny, and he has made a destiny for you. He set a destiny in your place, and your destiny is flowing with milk and honey. Your destiny is flowing with blessings. And you say, well, I just walk right up in it. No, you have to sometimes defeat the enemies that are trying to keep you from your destinies. And we looked at these, and we got to understand that you say, well, I don't know about all that. I come by to tell you, God knew what you were going to do before you were born. He told Jeremiah, he told him, he said, before I formed thee in the belly, I knew thee. He said, before thou camest forth out of the womb, I sanctified thee, and I ordained thee to be a prophet unto the nations. You say, well, I'm not a prophet, and I'm not a preacher, and I'm not a teacher. I don't care if you're none of that. God has a destiny for every born-again saint of God. You may not be a preacher, and you may not be a teacher, but you could be a Sunday school worker, or you could be on security, or you could be doing a number of different things. It may be even outside the main sanctuary, as we've seen today. You've got to understand that God has given you a purpose and a destiny. I say this all the time, but hear me. God didn't make no junk. God made men and women of God. If you've been born again, he made you for a purpose in this life. He made you for a purpose in his kingdom. He made you for a reason. Hear me, sons. Hear me, daughters. Hear me, men. Hear me, women. God made you for a purpose, to do something for the kingdom of God. He didn't just sit. Can I say this? I'm getting way off subject. He didn't just save you for you to sit in the pew. He didn't save you to sit in your car like we've been doing. He didn't save you just to take up space. Come on now. He saved you for a purpose. He saved you for a reason. He redeemed you for a destiny. He done laid out before you. You ever knew what the destiny was, he done set it in motion. But the enemy is out there, and the enemy is out to kill, steal, and destroy. And God said it in here. He said, you're going to face nations that are mightier and greater than you. There's a fight in this thing. There's a struggle, a warfare in this thing. The Bible said, we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities and powers and rulers of darkness. He said, there's a fight. Paul said, I fought a good fight. Understand tonight, you just don't walk up into your destiny just like you had walked through, tiptoe through the tulips, just like everything, sugar and spice, to fulfill the destiny God's got for you. There's a fight and there's a struggle in this thing. But God said, even though they're stronger in you and even though they're mightier in you, he said, I done gave it to you. He said, I done gave it to you. He said, and the Lord thy God, verse 2, shall deliver them before thee. He said, and thou shalt smite them and utterly destroy them and show them no mercy. I come by to tell you, these seven enemies of your destiny, if you'll smite them, show them no mercy and utterly destroy them, you will fulfill your destiny. It's a fight tonight. Understand that. And here's the key. I want us to look just briefly at this. You got to understand, if you don't take these out, the Bible tells us in Joshua 23 and 13, it says, but they shall be a snare and a trap unto you, and scourges in your sides and thorns in your eyes. What he's saying is that enemy will trip you up, that enemy will trap you, that enemy will throw you off track. Not only that, it'll put a scourge in your means it affects the walk that you have with the Lord. It'll put thorns in your eyes, which means it'll affect the vision that God has given you. Amen. So with all that being said, and just to lay a little foundation, and hear me tonight, if you only get some of this series, you've got to understand you have a destiny in God.
You've got a land that's flowing with, spiritually, it's flowing with milk and honey. You've got a land that has blessings out there. And there's an enemy out there, and there's seven enemies, if you will. And we talked about the first ones. The first one was the Hittites, which was the enemy of fear. The Girgashites was next, which is the enemy to quit. The Amorites was next, which was the enemy of pride. And we talked about my mind went blank. We talked about the Canaanites, which dealt with money and wealth and putting your faith in money instead of God. And tonight we're going to talk about the Perizzites. And I know we look at this and we examine these types of enemies that we're seeing. You said, and understand that names were given in the ancient time at a simple approach, if you will, to the names. They would call people or kingdoms based on obvious traits like their character, their traditions, and their occupations. These seven nations had character traits. We just listed the first few that we went over already. And it's saying this is what these people were like. And we too have the same enemy sometimes that tries to defeat us. But here's what I want us to look at, and just real quickly to grab hold of this. Once you can recognize an enemy, then you know how to defeat him. Once you realize who he is and what he does and how he affects you, you can defeat fear over faith. Come on now. You can defeat faith. Faith is the main thing here. Even with the Girgashites, you put faith over quitting. Come on now. With the Amorites, you put faith over pride. And with the Canaanites, you put faith over money. Amen. And tonight, we're going to talk about the Perizzites, or Perizzites, however you say that. These people were people who had separated themselves and lived in unprotected and unwalled villages. Basically, they had no discipline or restrictions. Today, where they would say they would have no self-discipline or self-control. Yeah, I know some of you may have shut me off. You probably shut me off last week when we got talking about money. But I want you to understand something tonight. The Bible is teaching us that this is an enemy that plagues a lot of men and women. It's called, and especially godly men and women. And we know it plagues the world in itself. It's called self-control and self-discipline. Now, nobody likes to talk about discipline. We don't like to be disciplined. Do you remember as a child being disciplined? They do it different now than when I was growing up. Today, they put you in time out. Back then, my daddy would take me out to the woodshed. Come on now. There's discipline, and there's right discipline, and there's wrong discipline. I want you to understand something. I know you shouldn't. I ain't talking about beating children. I ain't talking about that. But what I am saying, that belt and that switch sure did wonders in my life to discipline. Send me down the right path. Amen. But this is some self-discipline. This is not where somebody disciplines you from an outside thing, but it's discipline that you have to learn to discipline yourself. You have to learn swapping mics here. The other one's messing up a little bit. But you have to learn to discipline yourself. You have to have self-control, and you have to have self-discipline. The Bible says in Proverbs 25 and 28, it says this, "He that hath no rule over his own spirit is like a city that is broken down and without walls." What it's saying here is that if we don't learn to govern ourselves, I want to stop right there and say this. It's through the power of Jesus Christ working down on the inside of you through all these enemies you have to defeat. It comes by God, where you become a new creature and a new creation in Jesus Christ, that you're able to recognize these enemies and overcome them. But it's saying here in this passage of Scripture, he that has no rule over his own heart, he that maintains no government of himself, if you will, of his own fleshly appetites or his own fleshly passions or his own fleshly desires, what he does is he allows the enemy with the broken down walls. It means your walls are broken down, and everybody knows what a wall's for. A wall is to protect. The wall is to keep people from coming in that don't need to be in. Come on now. Not only that, it helps protect you from going out when you shouldn't go out. And we see tonight, I want you to look at tonight just for a moment, that those who don't have self-control and those that don't rule over his own spirit and those that don't have self-discipline, you're like a city whose walls have been broken down or there was none built to start with. It allows you to go after your own fleshly desires and your own fleshly passions and your own fleshly appetites, if you will. What happens is, if you don't govern yourself, we provoke and it breaks. If we're not careful, it allows that one would be like a city that is broken down and don't have any walls. And what it does, it exposes ourselves to all the temptation that Satan has, and you become an easy prey for the enemy. I'm going to let that sink in. If you don't have self-discipline and self-control, then you're easily tempted. If you don't have walls built up and you don't have a hedge around you, if you will, what you do is you allow your own flesh to take over. And the enemy, through his temptations, will draw you out, and you become easy prey for the enemy to destroy your destiny. I know this is a tight subject, and we don't like to talk about discipline, but discipline, if you will, is something we've got to get a hold of. Discipline is something that is a root word that we even have in discipleship. I want to say this before we move too far. Self-discipline. You've got to have some discipline in your life. You've got to discipline yourself to read the Word of God every day. You need to read the Word of God. You need to get it down and read it every single day. If it's a chapter, good. If it's a couple of verses, good. But you need to get it down on the inside of your heart. How many know at any time in life you go and you got to discipline yourself in prayer? You got to have a time set aside to pray, because if you don't pray and you don't read, that is how you build the walls of faith around you. That is how you build the walls to let you know what not needs to come in and what not's pleasing unto God. But you got to understand that you've got to learn to do these things. You've got to make a time, because I want you to understand something. The devil will use up all your time. Yourself will use up all your time. You'll start to pray. You'll start to read. A knock on the door, a phone call will come. Sometimes you got to shut that stuff off, and you got to get into the Word of God every time. There is things you have to discipline yourself over and through. We got to learn to do this, because without a walls, if you will, of self-discipline and self-control, then you become easy prey for the enemy to allow your destiny to fulfill. If you're not careful, when you do these things and you, in the enemy, you become an easy prey for the enemy, he will draw you back out into the worldly lusts, out into the worldly desires, and out into the worldly appetites. Somebody hear me tonight. You're sitting there tonight and you've thought about things you shouldn't be thinking about. You're watching things. I'm going to get into this. I can't help it. You've been watching things you shouldn't be watching. And you've been talking to people you shouldn't be talking to. But I come by to tell you, you've got to learn to have some self-control and self-discipline. It's through the power of God living down on the inside of you. Proverbs 4:23 says, keep thy heart with all diligence, for out of it are the issues of life. That word keep can also be translated as guard. We got to learn to guard our hearts. We got to learn to protect, not necessarily the pumper, but the heart of man, the inner man. We've got to learn to protect him. We've got to learn to put up guards. We've got to learn to put up hedges, if you will. We got to learn to put up walls. I want you to understand something tonight. We say it all the time. An alcoholic can't go to the bars. You know why? Because he'll be in there, the next thing you know, he'll be sipping on that alcohol again. A drug addict can't go to the crack house. Why? Because it won't be very long. He'll be partaking in that. And I want you to understand this. A person who struggles with pornography ought not to be on the websites that show that stuff. You got to be careful. Come on now. We got to be smart enough. God's given us an intelligence, and God's given us common sense and the ability to guard myself and don't put myself in positions that I can't get out of. Don't put myself where the devil easily tempts me, because if I don't have self-control and I don't have self-discipline, I become an easy prey to that temptation. Amen. Think about this. A lot of us know who Billy Graham is, just a prime example of guarding your heart. Billy Graham, when he would go on his crusades, him and his secretary would never stay on the same floor. He never met with any woman of that team by him and themselves. I don't care if they were in public or if he's downstairs. He would always meet with a group, because that's called guarding your heart. Can I say this to married people? You should not go to lunch, and you should not be in a car by yourself with somebody from the opposite sex unless it's your wife or a family member. Come on now. You say, well, I won't ever do nothing. Well, you might not. But I'm telling you what, if you don't have some guards up, the enemy will and can and has tempted. Let me, oh, help me, Lord. I'm going to go here. This is a phone, if you can't see it back here. But you better be careful who you allow to be friends on your Facebook. I'm going to smile real big. This ain't too bad preaching like this, because people, you don't see what they're looking at. You don't know if they look like they're going to stone you. And they don't look like you don't even have to worry. If you're watching, nobody knows if you got that guilty look. Come on. But you got to be careful. You got Billy Graham not only did that, somebody would go in his room before he ever went in there and sweep his room to make sure nobody was in there that shouldn't have been in there. You say, well, that's plumb silly. No, it's not. It's called guarding your heart. It's called making sure things are in right order, making sure you don't stumble out of the way, making sure that things don't come against you. I want you to understand something tonight. We have to learn. Here's the problem we have in Christianity. Here's the problem we have in the church world tonight. We wouldn't let our children do it. We wouldn't let them watch certain things or listen to certain things. But when we become adults, we almost feel like we can handle it.
Well, I can watch that show. It won't bother me. I can watch it. I can listen to that music. It won't bother me.
I got news for you. It will and does affect your mind. It will and does affect your spirit. Somebody hear me tonight. If you got the remote control, you know it's got an on and off button. Mine's got one. It's got a channel changer. I'm telling you right now, I help me, Lord. I just feel right now, somebody needs to hear this. You've been watching some junk, you know, through this pandemic that ain't holy and that don't benefit your spirit one bit. And if we don't learn to guard ourselves from television sometimes and social media sometimes and Hulu and Netflix and all that stuff, we binge watch some stuff we shouldn't even been watching. My Lord, help me. I'm going here. I can't help it. I believe in a sanctified life. I believe you got to have some self-control. I got news for you. If you got trouble with lust, you need to be careful what you're watching. If you got trouble with drugs and alcohol, you need to learn to cut that mess off your television. You say, well, I can't cut it off. I got news for you. Cut the cable off. Quit paying the cable bill. You'll save $100 or $200 a month. You can eat some more groceries on it. Come on now. You got to get a hold of this tonight. You've got to put stuff in your life that'll keep you from being, or keep you from protected and guard yourself and guard your inner life, because the enemy, you've got a destiny and it's hindering you from your destiny because you can't shake the thing that calls you in the middle of the night, because you ain't put something between you and it. You ain't put the word of God between you and it. You ain't put your prayer life between you and it. Every time you feel like you're going forward, something snaps you back because you have not learned to have self-control and self-discipline against the things that hinder you in life. Woo! Help me, Lord. Good gravy. Somebody help me tonight. You watching, you ought to give the Lord a praise. And if it's you, if it ain't you, you ought to say amen. If it is you, say, oh, mine, I'm moving up. I'm getting a hold of this picture. You got to learn to cut that stuff off. Somebody help me tonight. No, wait a minute. I'm going to stop right here, because some of you know that technology is why we're doing what we're doing. And the first time in my life, I'll just be honest, I got a Facebook. Because we were trying to get the word out, and we're trying to preach, and we're trying to teach, and we're trying to share things that God had given us because we weren't able to assemble ourselves together. But I said it last week, money is neither evil nor good. I come by to tell you, technology is neither evil nor good. It's what you do with it. We've been using it. We're using it right now for good. We're using it right now to get the gospel out. But the same good, the same technology can be used for evil. Come on now. You can watch pornography. Let's just be real. You can look at stuff you shouldn't be looking at. Let's be real. You can listen to stuff you shouldn't be listening to. Let's get real. You've got to learn to have that self-discipline in your life to cut that mess off. Because if it's not, you become an easy prey to the enemy and the temptations that he gives you, that you'll fall back out. You see the picture. I hope I'm painting it. But a Nehemiah, one of the biggest things is when Israel had been conquered as a nation, and Nehemiah was back in the kingdom that had conquered them, the Babylonians. And Nehemiah goes before the king, and he's sad. And the king says, what's wrong with you, Nehemiah? And Nehemiah says, man, I've heard some terrible news, basically. This is roughly translated. But he said, I got some bad news about my homeland. The walls are tore down and the gates are on fire, which means they're a prey to the enemy. They're a prey to the enemy. And hear me tonight, if you don't learn to have some self-control and some self-discipline in your life, you've got to learn to guard your heart. Verse 25 of chapter 4 of Proverbs says, let thine eyes look right on. Let thine eyelids look straight before thee. Understand me tonight, you've got to be careful what comes in your vision. You've got to be careful of what comes in your gate. Job said it this way. He said, I made a covenant with mine eyes. Why then should I think upon a maid? Help me, married men. Help me, single men. You got to be careful how you look at a woman. You got to be careful. He said, I done made a covenant with my eyes. What he means is when that stuff comes on, I cut it off. Come on now. We got to get real tonight. I believe God is opening up an opportunity during this pandemic to innerly look into ourselves spiritually and understand we have a destiny, but we've got some things in our life we've got to get out of the way and some enemies we got to defeat to fulfill that. And this one tonight, I thought about this. I thought, Lord, this is going to be a tight message, another one. I had one last week about money. Now I got one about self-control and self-discipline. You have got to learn to discipline yourself. I can't help but say it. Somebody's watching. Maybe I just feel it in my spirit tonight. You've been watching some filth you shouldn't be watching. You've stayed at home. You've been self-quarantined. You've had shelter at home, and you ain't had nothing on your mind but idle time. I come by to tell you, cut off the television and get into the Word. Cut off the Facebook and get into His book. My Lord, I feel Him. Somebody tonight has got to get a hold of this. You got to have something to guard your heart with. It's through the Word of God. David said, I hide my word in your heart, God, that I might not sin against you. You know how you know that you ain't you. My Lord, help me. I'm trying to slow down. But you got to get a hold of this tonight. You have got to learn to put things in your. Every time you build a wall, you lay it brick by brick, stone by stone. Every time you cut that mess off, you're laying a stone on top. Every time you quote a scripture, you're laying another rock in its place. You're putting mortar up, and it's protecting you from the enemy, and it's protecting you from your own fleshly desires and from your own fleshly lust. Come on now, from your own fleshly appetite. Now, you might be holier than most people watching tonight, but I got news for you. If you ain't careful what you... Help me, Lord. I'm going to say this. I'm going to give you some good words of wisdom that I heard a long time ago. Some people say, well, I don't know if that's a good movie or a bad movie. Well, I got news for you. This is a good way to judge it. If you're not really sure, and if you got enough of the Word of God in you, you'll really know. But if you just don't know, I'm going to challenge you with this. Would you allow someone to come into your house and sit on your couch and handle the language that they do on some TV shows or movies? Would you allow a couple to come into your house and make out on your couch in front of your wife and your children? Would you allow that? If you won't allow that, then that's a good sign that that's a bad show, because what you've done when you turn on the television or pop into they do VCRs anymore, the DVDs, or you flip up Hulu and you flip up Netflix and they some ungodly mess on there. If you would not allow that to take place in your home in front of your wife and in front of your children, then I got news for you. When you turn on that mess, you're allowing it to be right there in your living room. They might as well be on your couch. They might as well be in your kitchen doing what they're doing. I hear me tonight. Somebody's got to learn to get a hold of this. I can't get off of it. I got some other stuff I need to move to, but somebody... It just really run through my spirit just a few minutes ago that somebody in this crisis have been sitting at home looking at stuff. It don't have to be on the TV. Most people watch a lot of stuff on iPads and on Facebook and on their phones and on social devices. Hear me tonight. If you're watching stuff that is ungodly and unholy and contrary to the Word of God, you better cut it off, because what you're doing is you're losing your self-control and your self-discipline, and you become an easy prey to the enemy. You say, where do you get that mess from? How do you figure it? I got it under control. I got news for you. If you're watching ungodly stuff, listening to ungodly stuff, come on now. Let's just hit music while I'm at it. You got to be careful what you listen to on the radio. It better be born again, saint of God. I don't care if it's Southern gospel. I don't care if it's hymns. I don't care if it's contemporary. You ought to be listening and should be listening to Christian music that uplifts your life, that uplifts your spiritual walk. How many times have we stood back and we've listened to music that took us back to the old times when we were sinners? Come on now. And we think about it. We've been delivered from that mess. Why would we listen to something that will draw us back out into that mess? Hear me tonight. You better be careful of what music you're listening to. You better be careful of what music you got your ears tuned to. If it don't lift up Jesus Christ and it don't lift up the kingdom of God, I give you fair warning, you need to have some self-discipline and change the radio station, change the TV station, change whatever you need to guard your heart and protect yourself. We used to say it all the time. It's an old saying. It tear my beer was country music. Not my girlfriend's gone, and I sure do miss her. But the fact of the matter is, every time you feed your mind with that mess, you're allowing the enemy to come in. You have got to learn to have some self-control and self-discipline in your life. Amen. You got to be careful. You say, well, I don't know about all that. I tell you what, let's give you a good example. There was a man named David. And there's a lady named Bathsheba. David was the king. 2 Samuel, I didn't give them this passage of Scripture, but I'm just going to read it just real briefly because you can see it. If you got your Bible, 2 Samuel chapter 11, verse 1. Samuel came to pass after the year was expired, at the time when kings goeth forth to battle. But David sent Joab and his servants with him and all Israel, and they destroyed the children of Ammon and besieged Rabab. But David tarried at Jerusalem. Woo, help me there. David shouldn't have been there to start with. Come on now. David should not have been there to start with. The Bible we looked at in Proverbs 4 and 26 says, ponder the path of thy feet and let all thy ways be established. David shouldn't have been there. David should have been out to war with his men. But he got comfortable and he got complacent and he let down his guard. I'm telling you, it's very important. Keep your heart with all diligence. Guard your heart with all diligence. That word diligence means careful and persistent work or effort. It's a persistent work. It's a careful work. It's a work that effort that we're doing to guard ourselves. And here's David, the king. Should have not have been where he was. I hear somebody hear me tonight. You ought not be going to places you're going. Come on. Come on now. Let's just get real tonight. We're too close to the end of times to be playing games. We're too close to the end of time to be just in walking through the tulips, if you will, or just bluebird on my shoulder kind of thing. We're too much close to the end of time. We've got to get a hold of this before your destiny lays before you. And it said it came to pass in verse 2. It said, at evening time, David arose from off his bed. He'd been sleeping too long anyway. Come on now. Man sleeping half a day away. And walked upon the roof of the king's house, and from the roof he saw a woman, washing herself. And the woman was very beautiful to look upon. David had allowed his guard. He wasn't where he should have been. He's laying around during the day. What it means was he became complacent and lackadaisical to guarding of his heart. Somebody hear me tonight. You've let down the guard. Somebody, I feel it in my spirit. You say, how can you feel it and you ain't even seeing us? It don't matter if I see you or not. You're watching this and you're hearing this. And you've let the guard down on your heart. And David did the same thing and said he looked after a woman. You know what David's problem was? He looked too long. He looked too long. Understand this, whether this woman was in the right of her, people say, well, she shouldn't have been on top of the roof taking a bath. That don't matter. David shouldn't have been looking. David shouldn't even have been there. Come on now. You shouldn't have been looking. You shouldn't have even been there. You shouldn't have been listening to that stuff. You shouldn't be following somebody on Facebook you know you shouldn't follow. You shouldn't friend somebody on Instagram and Twitter that you shouldn't. Come on now. Help me. Help me at your house. If you amen it, amen it. And David, it said, he inquired of this woman. And one said, is this not Bathsheba, the daughter of Elam, the wife of the Uriah, the Hittite? Hear me tonight. You have got to learn to have some self-control. The Bible teaches us in Galatians chapter 5, verse 22. It's one of the fruits of the Spirit. It said, but the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith. Verse 23 says this. Meekness, temperaments, self-control. Self-control. It's one of the fruit of the Spirit. I, through the power of God living down on the inside of me, have to understand that I have to discipline myself and have self-control of myself to not put myself in situations and not look at things and watch things. It calls David a great king, a man after God's own heart. He let down his guard. He wasn't where he should have been. He was looking at stuff he shouldn't have been watching. He become complacent, if you will, sleeping the day away, and lackadaisically found. It caused him to become an adulterer and a murderer. The wall had fell down, and he became an easy prey to the enemy. I don't know who I'm talking to tonight. It may be just a handful of people. But understand this tonight, that temperaments, that if you will, that self-control, that self-discipline, If you don't learn to defeat that enemy or the lack of, you will become an easy prey to the enemy. James 1 and 14 says, but every man is tempted when he is drawn away of his own lust and enticed. Then when the lust hath conceived, it bringeth forth sin, and sin, when it is finished, bringeth forth death. He said, ooh. But every man is tempted and drawn away by his own. Hear me tonight. The devil knows what you're tempted with. What you're tempted with may not be what I'm tempted with. But I'm telling you right now, if you don't learn to diligently guard your heart and make an effort and a work to discipline yourself in the Word, discipline yourself in prayer, and discipline yourself of where you go and what you listen to and what you watch and who you communicate with and who you take part with and where you eat. The Bible went on to say in Proverbs there, don't turn to the right or to the left. He said, and then, I'm going to hit this and I'm going to run, okay, because I know this is a tight subject. But bounce up to verse 24. It says, put away with thee a forward mouth. Oh, I can't help but smile sometimes. Perverse lips put far from thee. Be careful. There used to be a little song, a little kid's song, and it would say, be careful, little eyes, what you see. For the Father up above is looking down in love. Be careful, little eyes, what you see. And I know sometimes we think, well, that's just a kid's song, but there's more to it. It says, be careful, little ears, what you hear. Be careful, little hands, what you do. Be careful, little feet, where you go. Be careful, little mouth, what you say. Be careful, little mind, what you think. For the Father up above is looking down in love. Be careful. That little song was teaching our children, or my age, I don't know if they sing it anymore in children's church, self-discipline and self-control by the power of Jesus Christ living down on the inside of me. I want you to understand something tonight. Parents, grandparents, teachers, leaders, doctors, lawyers, be careful what you say. The words will either build people up or tear people down. The Bible says the tongue is one of the uncontrollable and unruly things of the body. It said they could take a little rudder and turn a giant ship. They could take a horse and a bridle and guide a horse, a powerful beast. But man has a lot of problems controlling what comes out of this mouth. It's self-control and it's self-discipline. I know some people say, well, I'm angry. I get mad easy. I got a short temper. It's just an example. There's 100 other things. And they say, well, that's just the way I am. That's the way my granddaddy was. That's the way my great-granddaddy was. I want to say this very simple. That's hogwash. Because you either become a new creature or creation in Jesus Christ, and you're not the same man or woman you were when you were in the world. Now, it takes self-control. It takes self-discipline. Every time you control it, by the power of Jesus living down on the inside of you, you put another brick and you put another rock and you build a bigger wall. You guard your heart. You protect yourself. You protect your spirit. Hear me today, parents. You need to be kind to your children and speak life over them, not death. You need to speak life over them, not to run them down. Husbands and wives, speak kind words to each other. Speak kind words to each other, not harsh words. You go throughout the Bible, and I'm not going to hit this and stay very long, but the Bible teaches us a lot of things about the mouth and about the tongue. It's a little thing, it said, but it kindleth a great big fire. Sometimes you say things you can't ever take back. Once they're said, they're done. Once the hurt is inflicted, it's done. I don't know who I'm talking to tonight. But understand this. Once you say it. There was a great example I seen years ago. They took a tube of toothpaste, and it was just a simple demonstration, and they had a plate, and they said every time you said a certain word, you'd squirt toothpaste out. Every time you say the word what, somebody would read something. Every time they say it, you'd squirt it out. And then they would go back and say, every time I say how, put it back in there, in the tube. Our words are like a tube of toothpaste. You can't put the toothpaste back in the tube. And you can't put your words, and you can't take them back once they're said and done. Hear me tonight. It takes self-control, and it takes self-discipline. This is an enemy. The lack of self-control and the lack of self-discipline will hinder you from your destiny. Hear me tonight. I want to close with this little thought. David says this, 1 Corinthians 9 and 25. Every man that striveth for the mastery, every man, if you will, that striveth to be more like Christ, every man that striveth for his destiny, let's just put it that way. Paul's talking about wrestlers, and he's talking about fighters, and he's talking about those that run the race in this passage of Scripture. Is temperate. There's that word again. Temperate. Self-disciplined. A man who plays sports is self-disciplined. They work out. You got football players, they in the gym. They practice and they practice and they practice and they practice and they practice. They're in the gym. They're eating right. They don't run out and get the double quarter pounders and 10 bags of fries and Coca-Colas. They're disciplined themselves. They're hitting the weights. They're hitting the gym. They're running. They're working out. They're building themselves. They're strengthening themselves for the game that they're about to play. Paul was saying, he was talking about a runner. He was talking about those that wrestle, like we've seen some of the wrestlers, not the wrestlers on TV, but like high school and college wrestlers and Olympic wrestlers. They train constantly. Self-discipline. Self-control. They want to master their craft, if you will. He said it's temperance in all things. I like that because it didn't say some things. You got to have self-discipline and self-control in all things. Hear me tonight, ladies and gentlemen. Hear me tonight, brothers and sisters. If you don't do these things, you will be an easy prey to the enemy. Every time you have this self-control and you have this self-discipline, John said it this way. He said, I must decrease so that he can increase. Every time I say no to stuff on television, and every time I say no to stuff on the radio, and every time I say no to stuff on social media, and every time I hold myself from saying things I ought not to say or feeling things I ought not to feel, spiritually there's a brick that's added and a mortar put on and another brick and another brick and another brick and another brick to where I'm guarding my heart. And through reading the Word of God and understanding every time I read a passage of Scripture and every time I put that in my heart and every time I put faith over fear and I put faith over finances, I put faith over pride, I put faith over quitting, I put faith over my own fleshly desires and my own fleshly lusts and my own fleshly passions. Every time I'm in my prayer closet, every time God speaks to my heart, every time that he begins to build me up and say, you need to walk this way and not that way, you ought not to say that, you ought not to think that, be careful little hands what you do, be careful little feet where you go, be careful little mouth what you say, be careful little eyes what you see, be careful little ears what you hear, be careful, because if you don't, then you become an easy prey to the enemy. It will hinder your destiny. It will hinder your walk. It will hinder your vision. There will be a trap. Let me say this. I'm going to try to close. The enemy knows what buttons to push on you. Now, married folk sometimes know what buttons to push to make their spouse mad. Come on. You know how to rile her a little bit. You know how to get him up under his skin a little bit. And the enemy knows what buttons to push to make you mad. The enemy knows what buttons to push to draw you out. We have to learn to diligently guard our hearts. We have to diligently, it's a work, it's an effort. Every day, read your Bible. If you don't discipline yourself, Paul's teaching right here, the one that's going to be mastery of this fight, if you will, you have to learn to have temperance. You got to learn to pray your way through sometimes. You got to, and I'm telling you right now, in this time of the pandemic, you can't call on the pastor to come to your house. You know, they still won't let us in hospitals hardly, and they still won't let people in nursing homes yet. And I understand why. You got to learn to discipline yourself. You. Because you know what draws you out. You know what hinders you. You know what causes you problems in life. You say, well, I don't buy all that. I believe I can watch what I want to. I'm trying to close, but the Lord ain't let me. I don't know why. I'm back to this subject again. I can watch what I want and listen to what I want. It won't affect me. That's hogwash. I don't know if they know what that is up north or in any other country, but hogwash. That's where they wash an old hog off with the mud. And that's what runs down the off the concrete where you washed him off. That's hogwash. I won't tell on myself. Now, I wasn't born saved. I lived on the other side for a lot of years, for decades. But did you know today still me and my wife can be sitting in a restaurant when we were able to sit in restaurants, and some old music could come on the radio, some old country song or some old rock and roll song. And most people sit back and think, well, those words don't really mean anything. I listen to the beat and all that. I got news for you. That's hogwash. I should have named this one hogwash. Because that song can come on. The music can come on. And they say a few little words. And you know what? I can finish it. You know what that means is? That impacted my life. It's in my mind. Now, I don't act on it. But what I'm trying to teach you tonight is if you keep listening to that stuff, if you keep listening to the rock and you keep listening to the country and you keep listening to the R&B and the jazz and the big band era that doesn't edify your walk with the Lord, I'm telling you right now, you're tearing down the wall and you'll become an easy prey. Somebody hear me tonight. You're struggling with some stuff tonight. I don't know who this is for. Maybe somebody will share this. Maybe it's somebody you know. Maybe it ain't you. Maybe it's somebody you know. And you can. There's one thing about Facebook. You can share it. They can watch it. Somebody needs to hear me tonight. You're struggling with some same stuff you struggled with for years because you're still feeding your mind that same garbage. You must decrease so that he can increase. Your own fleshly desires, your own fleshly passions. And the more you self-discipline, and the more you self-control, and the more you read, and the more you pray, and the more you worship, and the more you get into the house of God, and the more you listen to services like this and teachings like this, I got news for you. The stronger you'll become, and your wall that surrounds your heart, that surrounds the inner being of yourself, will be stronger. Your walk with the Lord will be greater. But if you don't destroy this enemy, it will hinder your walk. And it will hinder your vision. Back to verse 23, 23, chapter 4 of Proverbs says, keep thy heart with all diligence, for out of it are the issues of life. One old saying says this, and I'll move on. If it ain't in the well, it won't come up out of the bucket. What are you putting in the well? What are you allowing into the well of your inner being where the issues of life come? Now, we know this, and I promise, you know what clothes means to preachers? If you're watching, if you've not been to church in a long time, clothes means absolutely nothing. What are you putting in? What are you allowing here? This enemy of the Perizzites, which was like an unwalled city, or walls that had been broken down, who had no self-control and who had no self-discipline. You'll become an easy prey to the enemy. But by the power of Jesus Christ living down on the inside of you tonight, you're a born-again saint of God. You got your name written in the Lamb's Book of Life. You've given power over the enemy. Not only that, we read that in Deuteronomy that he said, I done gave you the land. I done gave you the enemy. It may seem mightier and stronger than you. Hey, I said this, and I'm going to say this again. If you deal with certain areas, you need to find it in the Scriptures that help you fight that area. Write it down. Put it on your mirror when you shave or put your makeup on. Paste it in the car somewhere. Put it on your voice memo on the phone. Type it on your iPad in your notes. Whatever you need to do to help remind you that you're an overcomer and you're more than a conqueror and you're victorious in Jesus Christ. You can defeat this enemy if you'll learn to self-control and self-discipline. You'll learn to discipline yourself in the Word. You'll learn to discipline yourself with godly music. You'll learn to discipline yourself with godly entertainment. Come on now. Movies. There's Christian movies. There's stuff on there. Not all things is bad. Come on now. Don't get me wrong what I'm saying. But you got to learn to watch and listen what uplifts you in Christ. You have the power to defeat this enemy. The Bible says you have the power to smite it, utterly destroy it and show it no mercy. I come by to encourage somebody tonight. You have the power to defeat self-discipline or the lack of self-discipline and the lack of self-control. No different than you have the power to defeat pride, no less than you have the power to defeat fear, no less than you have the power to defeat quitting, no lesser than you have the power to defeat faith or money over faith. Now, I'm going to close. With all that being said, I want to say a word of prayer tonight. Because some of these issues are hard issues for people. Some's money. These enemies affect us all, but some are stronger than others in our lives. Some have stronger enemy. The fear is a stronger enemy. Quitting's a stronger enemy. Pride can be a stronger enemy. But no matter the strength of the enemy, God said they're going to be mightier than you, but he said they ain't mightier than me. He said, I done gave them to you. All you got to do is go in and possess it. All you got to do is destroy them. All you got to do is show them no mercy. Don't even give your daughters to marriage and don't even allow your sons to take their daughters. For your destiny to be fulfilled, you have to and need to destroy these enemies of your destiny. If not, there'll be a trap, there'll be a snare, there'll be a scourge in your thorn, there'll be thorns or scourge in your side, there'll be thorns in your eyes. If you don't learn to destroy this lack of self-control and this lack of discipline, you become an easy prey to your own temptations, to your own lust, to your own passions, to your own fleshly desires. I encourage you tonight, fight this fight. Fight this enemy. Destroy it with all your power that lives down on the inside of you. That same resurrection power that brought Jesus up out of the grave now lives in you. It can quench your tongue. It can quench your thoughts. And I'm going to say this, and I am going to pray. Be careful. Little eyes what you see. Be careful, little feet, where you go. Be careful, little hands, what you do. Be careful, little mouth, what you say. Be careful, little ears, what you hear. Be careful, little mind, what you think. There's a Father up above who's looking down in love. Be careful tonight. I'm going to close with that, and I'm going to pray. Father, we come to you tonight. First and foremost, God, thanking you for your word. First and foremost, thanking you. You have given us the power over the enemies of our destiny. Thank you, God, that through recognizing the enemy, we're able to defeat the enemy. We know how to build tactics against the enemy. We know how to strategize against the enemy, Father God. And we know through the power that now lives down on the inside of me, I am a victor, I'm an overcomer, and I'm more than a conqueror. This enemy has no place, no less than the other enemies. These enemies of our destiny have no place in our lives, for you have given us power to defeat them. And to utterly destroy them and to show them no mercy. Tonight, God, help your people, God. Help us, Father God. Move upon them, God. I don't know who this message necessarily was for tonight, but I just felt so impressed on some of this stuff tonight, Father Lord, that you begin to speak to your people in encouragement and empowering and equipping to defeat this enemy, God. I hope through these series, God, that people are recognizing the enemies and destroying them out of their lives so that they can fulfill the destiny that you've called them to do and you've placed in their lives, Father God. Whether it's just to be a parent or a grandparent or it's to be a teacher or if it's to be a preacher, if it's to be a doctor or a nurse or a truck driver or a grocery store worker or a restaurant worker, if it's just to be a good godly man and woman at their job, God, or at their home. You have a destiny, God. And God, as we recognize these enemies, God, give us the power that you promised us to destroy these enemies. And Lord, we ask you to move on your people, God. And we ask it right now by the power and by the authority and by the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Again, thank you for watching. Just a reminder, as I said at the beginning, in case you picked it up late, we will be going back into our main sanctuary at 10:30 next Sunday morning. That is Mother's Day. Don't forget to get your mama something, or at least give her a card or call her or if she's still with you. Don't forget that. Also, 8:15, we'll be having service in here Sunday morning the same time. We will be doing Sunday night on Facebook Live. We will be doing Wednesday night service in the main sanctuary. So please, if you're able to come out, be part of us as they're starting to open everything up. And again, I want to stress this. We're praying for you. We're praying God to continue to move and destroy this epidemic or this pandemic, excuse me, and to speak life into this world and that we can get back to normality. And I want to say this. If you've missed church as much as I've missed church, get here. The doors will be open. We're going to socially distance. And when you feel comfortable, even if you don't feel comfortable yet, when you do feel comfortable, the Bible teaches us, don't forsake the assembling of ourselves. Get yourself in the house of God. If you're watching and you know Jesus and you ain't been in church and maybe you belong to a church, you ought to get yourself back there. Come on. You come visit us. We're great. We'd love to have you. We'd keep you. But the fact of the matter is, if you belong to a body and God's called you in that body, then you need to be there. Amen. So with all that being said, I want to thank you for watching. Thank you for Facebooking. And like I said, on the Connect, on the Facebook page, please connect with us. Let us know if you need prayer requests. Let us know if you need anything. We're still trying to help people. If you'd like to give, give online. And hopefully we'll see you Sunday morning, bright and early, 10:30 in the morning. Amen. Thank you again.
I've been held by the Savior. I've felt fire from above. I've been down to the river. I ain't the same prodigal return. Thank God that yesterday's gone. All my sins are forgiven. And I've been washed by the blood. I'm no stranger to the prison. I've worn shackles and chains. I've been freed and forgiven. And I'm not going back. I'll never be the same. So I say, oh, my hope is in Jesus. God, my yesterday's gone. All my sins are forgiven. I've been washed by the blood. There's a kind of thing that just breaks me. Break him down to his knees. God, I've been broken more than a time or two. Yes, Lord. Then he picked me up and showed me what it means to be a man. Come on and sing. All my hope